Hi, it's Gertje, and I'm about to introduce to you the wonderful bikes that have been organized by Bike and Saddle to present trips in a very special way to the guests that will arrive at your lodge. But we need to try and give the guests the best possible experience that they can out of these bikes, and for that reason there are a couple of things that we need to make sure enhances their whole experience of the thing. And that would mean a little bit of maintenance and a little bit of care of the equipment that you've got here. And these are really, really nice bikes. It's not like a chain store bike, it's a decent bike. So what you have here is a bike with 27 gears, meaning it's 3 in the front, 9 on the back. Of course, you're not going to be using 27 gears because you have to use them in certain combinations that make sense. But I'll explain how to use that in a few minutes. The other thing that is very important that you're going to be doing is to wash the bike. And whenever it becomes necessary for the bike to have a bit of a service and a wash, there will be a procedure, and that is what I'm going to try and go through as briefly and as simply as possible for you. Okay, you will have some degreaser to use, and you need a bucket and a soft brush for that. The degreaser, simply put, to start off with the wash, you'll get your bike on the stand or upright, put a cup of degreaser in the bucket, and then you will clean the drivetrain. Drivetrain being this area over here. In other words, the back gears, chain wheel. That's your drivetrain. So undilute it, you'll take your soft brush and just give it a scrub all over around here, and then you fill the bucket up halfway with whatever degreaser is left with water, and you wash the rest of the bike, including tires, handlebar, frame, everything. But mind you, a soft brush, because you don't want to tarnish this wonderful paint job we've got here. Once that is done, you chuck out the soap and you put clean water inside, and with the same brush you wash off the bike with clean water. No shortcuts, in other words, no high pressure cleaners, hose pipes, dipping it in the farm pool or anything like that. It needs to be brushed off carefully. The reason for that is everything here is sealed, and if you use a high pressure cleaner or something, all the dirt goes inside instead of off the bike. So that's as far as the cleaning goes. Once it's dry, it needs a lube. Simply, I'll show you how. You have an aerosol lube supplied, which is green, a little bit different to this one. But basically, put it in the small gear at the back, cycle it backwards, and put your lube on, right, all the way around. Once that is done, just run it through the rag like that to get the lube off the outside of the chain, because it only really needs to be on the inside. That's your wash and basic maintenance. Only place that takes lube is the chain.
Gert, how often do we need to wash this bike?
Well, you have to... I'm sure you all have common sense, so what we need to look at is, you know, if the bike gets a little dusty or something like that, you just wipe off the frame where you can see that the dust is probably going to hurt the image of the bike or the pleasure that guys are going to get out of it. But it needs a wash when, if you look at the chain and the drivetrain, it's starting to form fairly large, like cakes of mud and thing over here. But actually, before you get to that point, it probably needs a clean. But I mean, judge it. If you can see that there's a residue forming and that the chain scrapes when you're riding, it probably needs a clean and a, you know, a bit of a lube.
And can I use any lube, or is it just the lube that Bike and Saddle provides?
The lube that Bike and Saddle provides is best, because it's a bicycle. It's a lot more sensitive than some other things, and if you use the wrong lube, it could be quite corrosive to the chain. And also, lubes that are not meant for bicycles tend to attract a lot of dust, and that just aggravates the wear and tear on the bike, generally speaking. Right, after your wash, most important for a lot of reasons will be the gears, and that it is very frustrating for your clients to, first of all, not understand exactly how the gears work, and if they do understand how it works, and it's not absolutely perfectly adjusted, they can struggle a little bit. There are two things here that we're going to be looking at adjusting. First of all, we are going to use these two screws at the back of the jockey, being your limit screws. Limit screws meaning they adjust how far the jockey can go inside and how far the jockey can go outside. Second thing we'll be doing is to adjust the shifting in between the different gears we've got at the back there. Right, to start with the limit screws, the first thing that one has to look at is that there is no damage to the jockey. Often it happens that a bike falls over or a customer had a small little accident or something like that, and then the jockey is at an angle like that. In other words, it's skewed. When that happens, it's best to contact Bike and Saddle to make sure that we get it sorted out. It just means that it needs to be in a straight position by changing the dropout section over here. But as far as the limit screws go, this one will adjust how far it goes out, in other words, toward the small gear, and that one adjusts how far it goes in other words, towards the big gear. One does the adjustment from here. I want to show you what happens if it's not correctly adjusted. To test the adjustment, you take the jockey with your thumb and just push it towards the inside. If it's not properly adjusted, this jockey will be touching the spokes, like so, and the chain will fall in between the gear and the spokes, and it's even possible that the jockey will get caught by one of these spokes and it rips it all the way around here, destroying the wheel, destroying the jockey, destroying the frame, causing generally just absolute havoc at the back here. So what you need to do is you need to adjust the limit screw, which I'm going to do now. If you turn it in, it stops it from going too far to the inside. So give it a couple of tweaks over there, push it with the thumb again. Perfect, not going into the jockey, and aligned with the top gear perfectly. Now we do the same for the bottom. If it goes too far to the outside, one adjusts it so that it doesn't happen. That's the limit screws. As far as the shifting goes, the shifting is controlled by the cable tension. You can see there's a pinch bolt there holding the cable, and the adjustment happens from the shifter at the handlebar. There's an adjustment right over here. That adjusts the cable tension tighter or looser. So in order for the gears to shift up, the cable gets pulled, and for it to shift down, the cable gets released. In other words, if you want to shift the gears up, you need to pull the cable, and to shift down, you need to loosen. So in an event where you're adjusting the gears and the gears doesn't want to shift to the next gear up, it would mean that the cable needs more tension. So in order to get the gears to shift up nicely, you need to tighten the cable tension. In other words, tighten this one. If it doesn't want to shift down nicely, the cable tension needs to slacken up. In other words, you turn it the opposite way. So there we go. I'm just going to show you what it should shift like. So for every click, it should shift directly to the next gear. All the way up, and then one by one, all the way down. There we go. That's it for the back. Now we have to look at the front gears. Just move the bike. The front chain wheel, the gears are controlled by the front derailleur. That shifts it from middle, from small to middle to big chain wheel. When we start adjusting this, it's very important to shift the gear from the smallest one into the biggest one at the back, which we'll do now. Right, there we go. The position of the front derailleur is crucial. That is the thing that makes it work or makes it not work. Easy way to start off is, that is the front derailleur cage. If you have it in the biggest one over here and the smallest one over here, there should be between the inside of the front derailleur cage and the chain, about a millimeter space. If there's not, it's going to touch and make that kind of noise while you're riding. Okay. That distance, that millimeter distance, once again, can be adjusted by your limit screws over here. So that outer limit screw adjusts the derailleur inside and outside. And then exactly the same applies to you being in the hardest gear. In other words, the small one at the back and the big gear in the front. This is the small ring in the front, middle ring, big ring. The small one naturally for going uphill. So that's your easiest gear. And then as you pick up speed out of the uphill, you would generally shift to the middle ring. And then as you go down the other side and pick up speed, the harder gear is the big blade over here. On the big gear, the chain should not be touching the outside of this cage. And when you're shifting into the big gear, the chain should not be thrown off the chain wheel. Once again, you can use your adjustment screw, limit adjustment screw, to stop the derailleur from going too far. And then, of course, if it is touching, like it is there, you can hear it touching. What needs to happen is that this derailleur needs to be further this way, so you need more cable tension. Once again, cable tension is adjusted. In other words, if you need to adjust this derailleur to go further outside, the cable tension needs to increase. So you will use this adjuster to increase the cable tension, or if it doesn't want to shift nicely, you have to, downwards, you have to release cable tension for it to shift more easily towards the inside. Once again, you will release a bit of cable tension from that side.
So Gert, what is clockwise is release?
Well, the thing is that
it changes.
They have to learn to do that. It's very difficult to explain because it's like three-dimensional kind of. When you turn it out, the distance changes and it takes up cable tension. So for them, generally, if you say you tighten it,
so it's in and out.
It's in and out. Yeah. So if you tighten it, it's out. If you loosen it, it's in.
Simple enough.
Simple enough. Yeah. Before we start adjusting the front derailleur, it's very important to check that the position of the front derailleur is good. It might happen that the position changes because of a bump or a loose bolt or something like that. So let's just briefly look at that. The first and most important thing is to shift the gears into the big one at the back being your easiest gear, and the small one in the front being your easiest in the front. What you need to look at is that should only be a millimeter gap on the limit screw there. And the second important thing is, if you shift this a little bit and you look over there, there should only be about a millimeter or two space in between the chain wheel and the front derailleur cage. That needs to be like that for the gears to function properly. The second important thing as far as the alignment of the front derailleur goes is to make sure that the angle of the front derailleur is correct. And once again, big chain wheel, big gear, and small chain wheel. The chain and the front derailleur should be parallel to each other, with only about a millimeter gap there. Then the gears work properly. Right. We're just going to briefly look at how to use the gears. In other words, what combinations of gears to use to get the best results out of your ride. As a rule of thumb, one tries to avoid the following combinations, and I'll explain to you in a minute why. If you're in the small one in the front, you should avoid using the two small ones at the back. Same goes the other way. If you're in the big one in the front, try and avoid using the big ones at the back. So that's two gears at the bottom, two gears at the top. And when you're in the middle blade in the front, don't use the top one, don't use the bottom one. So two gears again. The reason for that is that if you're on the small one in the front and the small one in the back, the chain crosses from the inside of the bike to the outside. Conversely, if you're in the big one in the front and big one at the back, it crosses from the outside to the inside. Nothing's going to get broken, but the gears make noise and it does influence the shifting and things wear out quickly. So what you need to do is the following. I'm going to show you the lightest gear on the bike. In other words, tackling the steep hills, you need the big one at the back, small one in the front, your lightest gear. So you're cresting the hill, picking up a bit of speed, and you start shifting down the gears one by one. Alright, there we go. And let's say you're roughly to getting to about the fourth or the fifth gear at the back. What you need to start doing when you get to about the fifth gear over here is to shift in the front. So technically your next gear will be the middle one in the front. I'm going there now. That's it. But the change in ratio between the small one in the front and the middle one in the front is quite big compared to the ones at the back. So your next gear would be from small to middle there, and then you kind of have to blend the gears in. So maybe, you know, shift one or two gears up at the front, at the back, to get your next ratio. So now you're on the flat, heading towards the downhill. Now you're on the flat, picking up speed. There we go. Faster, faster, faster. By the time you get here, you're starting to head for the downhill. Going really fast, the dust flying everywhere. You need to be shifting to the big gear in the front. So there we go, into the big gear. Alright, but once again, blend it in. So one or two gears up at the back. There we go, picking up speed, up speed, up speed. Doing 100 k's an hour in your hardest gear. There we go. Now, the next thing that you have to think of is the next hill. So as you approach the hill, you have to start shifting, because once you're up that hill and you're in the hardest gear, pedaling 500 watts into the cranks, you won't be able to shift because of the chain tension. So as you approach the hill, start gearing up at the back. There we go. Then the front. There we go. And again the front. And as you hit the crest of the hill, or where it starts getting really steep, you should already be in the smallest gear in the front. Very important to anticipate the shifting and to bring that across to your customers. Right, we're going to look at adjusting the brakes. The brakes are very straightforward because it's a hydraulic disc brake. In other words, it's got brake fluid like a motorbike or a car or something, with a master cylinder in the front, slave cylinder at the back. Before we start adjusting the disc brakes, there's one very, very important point, and that is the bike needs to come out of the stand and go to the floor. I'm going to show you why quickly. It goes out onto the floor. What I'm going to do now is to loosen the quick release, check that the wheel is in the center, retighten it, and it goes back on the stand. Okay, so here we go. The way to do that is put the bike on the ground, loosen the quick release. There we go. Roll the bike upright. See, there it goes. That's where it wants to be, in the middle.
Cool, got it.
Tighten the quick release, back on the stand. Now it's prepared for the disc brake to be adjusted. Very straightforward. The disc brake consists of two parts. You've got a bracket that holds it in position over here, and you've got two bolts up here. Those bolts loosen it so that it can be adjusted. So what I'm going to do is just loosen it a little bit there, loosen a little bit here. Now it can move freely. It's not loose, that it's going to fall off and go anywhere. It just moves freely.
I'm just going to get a close-up of that quickly and do that again.
Moving freely, quite simply, without being really loose to fall off. Just a couple of turns to get it loose. Here we go. To do the adjustment, very simple. Pull the brake lever. Right-hand one being the back brake. Pull the lever. As you can see, when I pull the lever, the caliper will center itself on the rotor. Retighten the bolt just a little bit to hold it in position. There we go. Spin the wheel. Give it a listen. Not touching anywhere. When it's not touching and you're happy with the adjustment, just give it a good torque on the bolts. There we go. Spin it again. Perfect. Moving freely. Occasionally it does happen that the disc brakes will drag a little bit. It's natural because of dust, or maybe the rotor is not perfectly in alignment or anything. But if you grab the wheel and you give it a spin and you count, hopefully not falling asleep, if it goes around 10 times, it's running freely enough. If it's less than 10 times, redo the adjustment. So there we go, adjust it, repeat the process on the front. Out on the trail with your guys riding, there are basically three things really that can put you out of commission, all three of which is very easy to deal with out on the trail. The first thing would be a puncture. Very simple, change the tube, use your patch kit and fix it. Let's look at that first. So you've got a puncture on the rear wheel, most difficult to remove. I'm just going to briefly show you how to get the wheel out of there. Flip the bike upside down. There we go. Undo the quick release. There we go. The difficult part is to get the wheel out. Right, before you flip the bike upside down, make sure that you've got the chain on the smallest gear. In other words, shift the bike to the smallest gear. That'll really help you get the wheel out and back in. Now, once the bike is upside down, smallest gear, quick release, undone. What you need to do is pull the jockey back, right? That opens up this area so that the wheel can come out. Pulling it back, and then simply the wheel is out, right? Fix your puncture, change your tube, whatever the case may be, inflate it, and let's get it back in the bike. Once again, to the front. Chain in between those two parts, pull the jockey back, let the chain rest on the smallest gear there, and just drop it into the frame. Right, something else that you need to look at, remember to aim your rotor in between the two brake pads. If the wheel doesn't go in, there's a reason for it. Don't try to force it. Check that everything is nicely aligned, aim it between the two brake pads, and just there we go, and push it down, in it goes. Tighten the quick release. There we go. Spin the wheel to see that it moves freely. Moving freely, there we go. The second thing that might irritate you on the trail and put you out of condition is a broken chain. I'm just going to show you how to put a master link in that'll solve the problem very easily. First of all, you find the offending link that is broken, and you have to take it out so that you've got two ends that look like that. In other words, the inside of the chain needs to, both open ends need to look like that. So, say for instance, this is the link that had broken, you need to take it out. That's where the chain breaker comes into play. Fit it into its slot. And with your chain breaker, there we go, you can push the pin out. So we push the pin out. Don't mess around, just push it all the way out. There we go. Two open ends. Alright, and then you need your master link. Master link consists of two little pieces.
Okay, I'm gonna get tight on those. Okay.
Yep. There we go. So one goes in one way, the other goes in opposite way. There we go. And then simply it is a little bit fiddly. There we go. Once it's in that position, you just give it a bit of a jab on the chain and it clips in, and your problem is sorted out. Right, the last offending part that may cut your ride short would be a wheel buckle to the extent where it doesn't want to turn through the frame anymore. You can see this one turns freely, but if it's severely buckled, it might be touching the sides over here. Now, wheel building is not all that easy, but getting out of trouble and getting home is not too bad. For that, you're going to need a spoke spanner. Yours doesn't exactly look like that, but it does the same job. If you look at a wheel, you can see that some of the spokes are angled this way, and other spokes are angled that way. So if you want to move this wheel this way, the spokes going that way needs to be tightened, and the opposite, if you want to go that way, you have to either tighten the spokes on this side or loosen the spokes on that side. That's where the spoke key comes into play. So, say the wheel is this buckled this way, you might loosen that spoke or tighten these ones. And when you need to solve a problem like that, it doesn't help to use one spoke. Always use across the wheel, say, 5 or 6 spokes in combination. In other words, if you want to move the wheel that way, that one can be loosened. There we go. That one can be tightened. This one can be tightened. That one can be loosened. Until you've got the wheel in such a state that it's able to turn and you can get home. And probably if it's buckled that badly, it would need to be replaced or properly repaired by someone qualified. Before going out on the trail, you have to make sure that everyone's got the correct bike. And the bikes come in 3 different sizes to suit the rider. There will be a small, medium, and a large bike. This would be a medium bike. And to start out the sizing, you will have to kind of put someone on a bike. It's very simple. Get on, I'll get the client to get onto the bike, hold on to something or help them stay upright. Put this pedal in the lowest position, as far as it can go down. You put your heel on the pedal. Once your heel is on the pedal, it should just be touching with your leg stretching. If it's not like it is over here, the saddle needs to go down. Or if your knee is bent with your heel on, it needs to go up. What you want to end up with is when your foot is on the pedal, you've got this natural sort of curve in your leg. I'm just going to adjust the saddle to a position that would suit me to indicate how this will work. Obviously this one's too high. Move it down a little bit. Try again. There we go. Heel on the pedal, leg straight. Now if I pedal, just natural curve in the leg. And obviously some people may feel comfortable in a different way, but that's a very good guideline. Second thing that you need to look at is probably I would ride a size smaller than this. The reason is it's quite important that one gets the saddle and the handlebar around about the same height. Obviously if it's an inch below or an inch above or so, that's perfect. But if it gets much of a bigger change than this in between the handlebar and the saddle, it's probably worth changing a size down for this one, or if it's saddled somewhere over here, it's worth changing a size up. If you do that, you will solve the second problem, which is the distance from the saddle to the handlebar. Because as the bikes get bigger this way, they also get longer. So size down would be shorter, size up would be a little bit longer. Yeah.